Welcome, friends. Welcome back to the kitchen. Welcome back to Sunday morning in the old cookbook show. Today we're going to do another recipe out of one of these Good Housekeeping cookbooks. This one is called Good Meals and How to Prepare Them, and the subheading is A Guide to Meal Planning, Cooking, and Serving, Catherine A. Fisher, Director of the Good Housekeeping Institute. This was published in 1928, and it says at the front that it's not for sale. It's only for people who subscribe to the magazine. And so 1928, this is about a year before the Great Depression starts. And the recipes in it are fantastic. The recipes in all of the Good Housekeeping cookbooks that I have from this time period are written extremely well. The flavors may not translate to 2021, but the instructions are fantastic. They really give you great details. They do have some things, though, where you need to know what's going on in order to accomplish the meal. And so the recipe we're going to do today is called Baconized Corn and Macaroni. The recipe tells me to start by cooking the macaroni. But in this instance, I don't think that's the best place to start, because one of the components of this recipe is a medium white sauce. And the recipe for the medium white sauce is at the back of the book. And there are charts at the back of the book for all of the sauces and the other components that you're going to find in multiple recipes. And so these little charts are just abbreviated recipes. They sort of assume that you know what's going on, but in order to make the white sauce, it takes 25 minutes. And I don't think I need to start boiling the pasta for 25 minutes while I make the white sauce. So I've got a double boiler on the go here, and the recipe says that I need to put in fat, and so I've got bacon fat, because what good North American household in 1928 didn't have a bucket of bacon fat in the kitchen? And I'm supposed to melt that, which won't take very long. And it doesn't take very long at all. I mean, it's almost melted just sitting here on the counter. It's a pretty hot day. I'm supposed to add into the fat our seasonings, which in this case is just salt and the flour. And stir that until we've got a nice paste. It also says a little bit of pepper, so let's grate in just a touch of pepper. Not much. Now I'm supposed to pour in cold milk and stir this until we get a nice thick sauce, cooking it for 25 minutes. And I guess while we're waiting for this to cook, let's talk about macaroni. I wouldn't go so far as to say that macaroni is a fascinating topic, but it is, I find it very interesting as I look at cookbooks from the earliest ones in my collection to these ones to what I see today. Macaroni is another one of those words that the meaning has changed over time. And today, 2021, I say macaroni. Anyone in Canada and the United States is thinking about this. These little short elbow macaroni shapes. I think the key thing to remember there is that it's called elbow macaroni. Historically, macaroni is just a generic term that means pasta. And any pasta shape could have been macaroni. Just like we would say, hey, let's get some fruit when we're at the grocery store. I'm not committing to any particular type of fruit. It could be an apple, it could be a pear, it could be an orange. I'm just gonna get fruit. And the same thing when I see macaroni in cookbooks from earlier than, say, you know, 1800. It probably could have been any shape of dried pasta. Around 1731 is the first mention of pasta with a hollow tube. And that is sort of a Swiss invention. And when I say Switzerland, it's in that borderland area between Italy and Switzerland, but today it's Switzerland. And that's the first mention in written form of a hollow tube of pasta. And it was long, it was like the length of spaghetti, and it was dried, and you would break it up and cook it. Probably wouldn't cook it whole. And so in a lot of cookbooks, say prior to 1800, that's what I see. Get some macaroni, break it up, and cook it. And they're meaning those long hollow tubes. The first time that this short elbow macaroni shows up is 1872. again, invented in Switzerland. And it just, that just seems so late to me. That form of macaroni doesn't show up until then. And it takes a few years for elbow macaroni to be shortened to just macaroni. And today, you see macaroni, that's immediately what you think of. But in the historical context, macaroni could have been anything. It could have been a lasagna sheet. It could have been spaghetti. It could have been rigatoni. It could have been a spiral. Pretty much anything like that. Okay, sauce is looking good. I think it's time to cook our macaroni. And on that topic, I've got some macaroni, elbow macaroni, and I've got some shells because that's all I had today. So in they go into the salted hot water. And I'll just give that a stir so they don't clump up and stick together. Okay, the pasta is cooked, so we're just gonna drain that out. And I don't need to save the pasta water today. Okay, so I'm gonna put the pasta into this jug. And to that, we add salt, pepper, cayenne, corn, and I'm using frozen corn. Now the recipe calls for canned corn. I'm using frozen corn because frozen corn is ubiquitous today. And I find frozen corn to be a little bit better than canned corn. Frozen corn could quite conceivably have been available in 1928 when this cookbook was written and published. The flash freezing method was invented by a guy named Birdseye in 1924. And there were a lot of patents that he got over his method of flash freezing fruit and vegetables. And he was selling it by 1928. Would not have been common, though. Would not have been common at all, because home freezers weren't as common, and canned corn would have just been easy, because you put it on a shelf, you can store it, you don't need electricity, you don't need to buy ice, you don't need any special equipment. So canned corn would have been probably what everybody used. Next, we put in the white sauce. And this is just a very simple, plain white sauce that, if I was making this today, I would have put 2 cups of shredded cheddar in here. But that's not what the recipe asks for. So in it goes, and we mix it all together. White sauce smells pretty good with that bacon fat. Okay. Once this is all mixed together, we pour it into a greased baking dish. Just sort of spread it around. And then put squares of bacon on top. Now this goes into a preheated 500 degree oven for 15 minutes. And I expect that the bacon should get nice and crispy on top, or at least I hope it will get nice and crispy on top. See you on the other side.
Hey, Glen.
Hey, Jules.
Hey, friends.
Spoon or fork? I'm not really sure.
I don't know either. I'm going to go with fork.
Give me a little scoop.
I'll do both.
There you go. Extra piece of bacon.
Woohoo!
So this is baconized corn and macaroni.
I think that's funny. Baconized. It's like, it's yeah, the modern idea of just throw some bacon on it.
Just throw some bacon on it. Well, I have come across a number of recipes from this time period where baconized is used.
It's not a new idea. Throwing bacon on it and throwing cheese on it, not a new idea.
Not a new idea.
anyway.
So it's hot. It just came out of a 500 degree oven.
Wow, that's really hot. Why so hot, do you think? Oh, because you cooked the bacon.
Okay. Cook and crisp up the bacon. Now the bacon's not as crisp as I thought it was going to be. That's pretty good. The corn and the bacon, and I used bacon fat to make the white sauce. You could use peas.
Mm-hmm.
You could use any frozen vegetable, I think.
You could just add some frozen vegetables to
it. Yeah.
Yeah. A mixed veg, and you could add cheese.
Yes. So this is pre-Depression, and I'm not sure why there's no cheese. But
Maybe whoever made it doesn't like cheese.
Well, and there's a whole tradition of white sauce pastas that are just that bechamel with the mm-hmm. pasta. So that would fall into that tradition. I'd put 2 cups of shredded cheese in with the white sauce, and it would be really good. It's good the way it is, though.
It has that. It has all the parts to be that comforting, hearty meal.
It's warm. It's comforting. I mean? It is.
If you threw this down on a cold day, you'd be like, yes.
If it wasn't 32 degrees outside today and even hotter in the studio, I'd be enjoying this more. If it was October, this would be fantastic. So I think this is a real winner.
I agree. I think it is a great base that you could really make into your family's dish.
Yes.
By putting in things your family really likes.
And it's probably something where you could hide some vegetables for those people that
really
don't like
vegetables.
I know Julie's not in that crowd. Julie would want more vegetables all the time. Thanks for stopping by. See you again soon.